In this segment, we'll briefly review the lighting calculations that you need to do in your ray tracer. Notice that the outline in code, we moved from generating the eye rays to finding the intersection points to now finding the color that should be assigned to a ray and surface intersection point. First, let's talk a little bit about shadows. So you have this camera and you shoot a ray to the object, and then you shoot a ray to the light source. If the shadow ray to the light source is unblocked, then the object is visible. On the other hand, consider another point here, and the ray to the light source is blocked, so the object is in shadow. There are, of course, numerical issues with computing shadows. What I want is that the ray goes to the light source and is unblocked, but what may end up happening is, for numerical reasons, and of course I've exaggerated this, the ray may actually fall below the surface, and then the surface may incorrectly end up shadowing itself. There's a simple solution, which is you move a small epsilon towards the light, maybe 1 part in 1,000 or 1 part in 1,000,000, before shooting the shadow ray. That's as far as shadow rays is concerned. And so the simple lighting model is that once you hit a surface, you first need to shoot a shadow ray. Each light is treated separately. For a given light, if the shadow ray says the light is blocked, there's no direct lighting contribution. If the shadow ray says the light is visible, we can apply the lighting model. For your homework, the lighting model used is really the same as in OpenGL. So you have lighting model parameters globally, which is the ambient RGB, and the attenuation, which is constant, linear, and quadratic. D is the distance to the light source. Then you have model parameters that are per light. So for a directional light, you have the light source direction and the RGB parameters, the color. For a point light, you have the location. So the real difference is whether the homogeneous coordinate is zero for a directional light or non-zero for a point light. There are some differences from the homework 2 syntax, but conceptually this part of the specification is almost exactly the same as in homework 2. Then you have the model for the materials. So you have the diffuse reflectance, which is the RGB colors, the specular reflectance, which is RGB, the shininess of the material, which is S, the emission RGB. All of these are essentially the same as in homework 2 as in OpenGL. Finally, I've written down explicitly the formula for the shading model. Notice first the ambient term, then the emission. So really your intensity is initialized by the sum of ambient and emission. Then we have the per light terms. For each light, what do you do? Notice the visibility term. This is different from OpenGL, which did not have you evaluate the visibility, but in the context of a ray tracer, it's easy to just shoot a shadow ray. If the shadow ray returns that the light is blocked, then you don't consider that light at all. Li is the intensity of the light. Of course, it's different for each color channel. Then you have the diffuse color, Kd, times max of L dot n and zero. Li is the direction to the light, plus the specular term times max of h, which is the half angle, dot n comma zero, and then s is the shininess. So this is the half angle. So notice that the visibility shadowing for each light, which is not in OpenGL. Also notice that this is, of course, evaluated per pixel per light. And in OpenGL as well, in homework 2, you wrote a fragment shader, so that's not new. But in the old days, OpenGL was evaluating per vertex, whereas in ray tracers, you always do it per pixel.